Dear students, Assalamu alaikum, Raban Darul Mubarak. I am going to take a class today on examination of the face, that is the examination mainly on fifth cranial nerve and especially the seventh cranial nerve. And I have missed two photographs on hypothyroidism and Down syndrome in my previous lecture. I'm going to discuss today. So this is Professor Mahmood Hassan from the Department of Pediatrics. Hemolytic anemia, already I have discussed in my previous class, that I'm not going to discuss today here. Let us start with the fifth cranial nerve. It has got two components, motor and the sensory. It has got three division, ophthalmic, maxillary, and the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve or fifth cranial nerve. The motor component innervates the muscles of mastication. These are the temporalis muscle, masseters, and pterygoid muscles. Pterygoid has two components, that is the medial pterygoids and lateral pterygoids. How do you examine the motor component of the fifth cranial nerve? So first of all, you have to give a look and see whether there is any visible wasting is present in the areas of muscles of mastication, that is over the areas of temporalis muscle or over the areas of the masseter muscles. You have to see on both sides by inspection, and during feeling tell the patient to clench his or her teeth. Then feel the masseters here, is masseter temporalis here over the temporal region, temporalis, and you can feel the masseter here while the patient clenches the teeth. During clenching, you can feel the temporalis muscle and the masseters. Why you want to see the strength of the pterygoid muscle, then tell the patient to open the jaw against resistance. Put your hand on the jaw and tell, give a pressure over the jaw, and then tell the patient to open the mouth against resistance. If it is possible, then the strength of the medial and lateral pterygoid muscles are intact. Sensory supply of the face is by the ophthalmic, maxillary, and the mandibular division of the trigeminal nerve. It also supplies the cornea, general sensation of the mouth, and the jaw jerk. You have to see it. You have to see the upper part of the face and the middle part of the face and the lower part of the face. Upper part of the face by the ophthalmic division, including the nose, and the middle part of the face by the maxillary division, lower jaw, and that is the lower part of the face is supplied by the mandibular division of the fifth cranial nerve. Remember that the then how will you examine the sensory supply of the fifth cranial nerve? With the help of the cotton, with the help of the pin, either with the sharp end and the blunt end. First of all, you have to explain the touches with the cotton ball, with the tip of the sharp point of the pin or blunt end of the pin. And then ask the patient to close the eyes before you start the examination of the sensory supply of the face by the fifth cranial nerve. And you have to look at the upper part of the face, middle part of the face, and the lower part of the face. With the cotton ball, when it touches, patient will say that whether he or she can feel the touch and what type of touch it is. Like this is the touch of blunt object. This is the touch with the sharp object. Again, you have to examine the face symmetrically on both sides, at the upper part of the face, at the middle part of the face, at the lower part of the face, either with the cotton ball, either with the sharp point of the pin or blunt end of the pin. Whatever it is, you have to touch it and then tell the patient to say what type of object he or she is feeling, and you have to compare on the both side of the face symmetrically. And the corneal reflex, you don't need to do in the examination exam hall, but this is the procedure with you have to do with the cotton, and you just try to touch the corneal margin with the side of the cornea lightly, and when the cotton touches the cornea, there will be blinking. It is normal. And the jaw jerk, you have to see the jaw jerk. Place your finger or thumb on the jaw between the lip and the lower end of the jaw, and then percuss with your hammer over your finger, and then there will be no movement of the mouth, or there will be slight opening of the mouth. This is normal. That is about the, these are all about the fifth cranial nerve, that is the motor component and the sensory component, corneal reflex and jaw jerk. Let us come to the another important cranial nerve, that is the seventh cranial nerve. It is a mixed type of nerve having motor root and sensory root. It supplies the muscles of facial expression, and sensory supply to the stapedius muscle, and spatial sensory supply to the anterior two-third of the tongue. This sensory supply that I have told you in the fifth cranial nerve, that is the general sensation. Here it is the spatial sensation of the anterior two-third of the tongue. For examination, tell the patient to look upward, close the eyes forcefully as possible, show the teeth and blow out mouth, and you have to look for nasolabial folds. So what to do? Here you can see the forehead wrinkling and the closing of the eyes as forcefully as possible, and and you have to try to open the eyes while the patient is closing the eyes forcefully as possible, and tell the patient to show the teeth and blow out the cheeks. This instruction you have to give to the patient during examination of the seventh cranial nerve, that is the motor component of the seven cranial nerves, that is it is supplies the muscles for facial expression. Normal motor function of the seventh cranial nerve, what to do you for looking at the normal fifth cranial nerve, seventh cranial nerve examination. Tell the patient to look upward or raise the eyebrows. You can see wrinkles on the forehead present on both sides, as I have shown in this picture. Wrinkling of the forehead is present on both sides. Close the eyes as forcefully as possible. Both eyes can close forcefully, and you cannot open the eyes while the patient is forcefully closing the eyes. Show teeth, angle of the mouth held upright, and no drooling observed. Blow out mouth, both cheeks popped out with each blow. And nasolabial folds, if you look, these are normal on both sides. This is a diagram showing facial nerve lesion Bell's palsy, that is the lower motor neuron type of lesion. If the lesion on the lower motor neuron type of lesion on the right side, you can see the changes of the facial expression in the same side, that is the ipsilateral side. Lesion may be within the nucleus or facial nerve. Here, supranuclear lesion on the left side, and you can see the changes in the facial expression. You can see the changes during examination on the right side. So if the lesion in of the seventh cranial nerve on the left side, you can see the changes within the right side of the face, that is the contralateral side of the face. Let us come to the examination of the lower motor neuron lesion on the right side. Tell the patient to raise the eyebrows or look upward. Wrinkles on the forehead absent on the right side. Here, wrinkling of the forehead will be absent on the right side. Close the eyes. Cannot close the right eye forcefully in case of lower motor neuron type of lesion. Here, eye will remain open, but in this picture, it is a defect. When the patient tries to close the eyes forcefully, the eye will remain open here. And if through the open eyes, you can see the eyeball is rolling upward. This is called upward rolling of the eyeball. In case of lower motor neuron lesion of seventh cranial nerve, this is called Bell's phenomena. And the lower motor neuron type of lesion of the seventh cranial nerve is called Bell's palsy. So you have to remember two terms. What is Bell's palsy? What is Bell's phenomena? Tell the patient to show the teeth. Angle of the mouth is deviated on the opposite side, that is the on the healthy side. Blow out mouth, cheek puffed out on the right side, and blow more than normal. Here the cheek will be more puffed out and it will blow more than normal. Second, Bell's phenomena, an upward deviation of the eyes on an attempted closure of the lids. In case of lower motor neuron type of lesion of seventh cranial nerve, which is a normal, the upward rolling of the eyeball is a normal phenomena which is preserved in lower motor neuron type of lesion and is seen when the eyes are closed, eye closure is incomplete in case of lower motor neuron type of lesion. Then come to the upper motor neuron type of lesion, that is supranuclear lesion on the left side. Tell the patient to look upward or tell the patient to raise his or her eyebrows. Here, wrinkling on the forehead present on both sides. Here, wrinkling present. And tell the patient to close his or her eyes. Both eyes can close forcefully. It is also preserved. Show the teeth. The angle of the mouth is deviated on the left side, same as that of the lower motor neuron type of lesion. Blow out mouth, cheek puffed out on the right side, and blow more than normal, same as that of the lower motor neuron type of lesion. So here, in case of upper motor neuron type of lesion, upper half of the face is function of the upper half of the face is preserved and lower half of the face is spared. But in case of lower motor neuron type of lesion, the function of the whole side of the both the upper and lower part of the face is affected. This is because the in case of upper half of the face is bilaterally innervated. If you look at this picture, here the these fibers are coming from the violet fibers are coming from the left side and the also from the right side, and the green fibers are coming from the left side. This is mainly from the left side, the green fibers, and violet fibers are from the both from the right side and left side. So fibers from the right and left side are coming here. So this portion of the face is bilaterally innervated. So in case of upper motor neuron lesion, the fibers from the right side are supplying. So this part of face, function of this part, upper half of the face is spared in case of upper motor neuron type of lesion. Due to this bilateral innervation of the upper half of the face. Special sensation of the tongue, you have to see for sweet, sour with the bitter, and you have to keep some sugar or salt or bitter things with you. For the special sensation of the anterior two-third of the tongue. And another thing, damage to the stapedius muscles, sound appears louder than normal. It is called hyperacusis. If you make a sound, it will appear much more louder to the patient. What type of complication you may have in case of Bell's palsy, that is the lower motor neuron type of lesion, or in case of seventh cranial nerve lesion, incomplete recovery. In case of lower motor neuron type of lesion, there may be chance of exposure keratitis, tics and spasm, contracture, psychological and social problem. Probable question for VIVA or OSPI, type of facial nerve palsy. How will you differentiate upper motor neuron lesion and lower motor neuron lesion? What is Bell's palsy? What is Bell's phenomena? Cause of Bell's palsy, what is Bell's phenomena? These are the questions you may ask in the exam. Let us come to the important picture or photograph you may have in your exam that I have missed in my previous class. The congenital hypothyroidism, this picture, examiner may ask you, look at the picture, the age of the child is 15 days and tell me the positive findings. Macroglossia, you can see here. And distended abdomen with umbilical hernia. Distended abdomen with umbilical hernia. And the face is not looking good. Coarse facial feature. What is your probable diagnosis? This is congenital hypothyroidism. Other clinical features you may have. There may be baby, maybe lethargic, constipation is there, and there is feeding problem, respiratory difficulty due to large macroglossia, dry skin, hoarse cry, prolonged neonatal jaundice, that is the neonatal physiological jaundice is prolonged. When the neonatal jaundice is prolonged more than 2 weeks, it is called prolonged neonatal jaundice, large fontanelles, and delayed closure of the fontanelles. Hypotonia with slow reflexes. These are the other clinical features of hypothyroidism. And the screening is very important. How will you confirm the diagnosis? By doing screening, by either just immediately after birth from the cord blood, or heel prick should be done on the 5th to 7 days of life for exam, for screening. For diagnosis, what to do? You have to do thyroid stimulating hormone and T4, TSH and T4. In case of congenital hypothyroidism, the TSH is high and T4 is low. Primary hypothyroidism, there are secondary and tertiary hypothyroidism that I have not discussed here. And thyroid scan with the 123 iodine or technetium M99 uptake, and scan is done to detect aplasia, hypoplasia or ectopy of the thyroid gland. And ultrasonogram of the thyroid gland, it may be enlarged or absent. And you can do for congenital hypothyroidism the skeletal survey. It is usually done on the knee joint. You can see absent distal femoral and proximal tibial epiphysis indicate congenital hypothyroidism at the 36 weeks of gestation. And treatment is replacement by the thyroid hormone, that is the thyroxine. In neonat, you have to start with a dose of 10 to 15 microgram per kg per day. Another picture, photograph. This is a child. You may have this type of picture. Photograph will be like this. And for explanation of the other clinical features, I have used this photograph here. Look at the picture and write down the positive finding. Probable diagnosis is Down syndrome. And cause of this condition, this is due to non-disjunction of the 21 chromosome resulting in extra chromosome in 21 position. This extra genetic material causes the developmental changes and physical features of Down syndrome. So, what are the findings you can see here in this photograph? Head, bradycephaly, it is not well visualized here. There may be microcephaly, but flat nasal bridge you can see, and the eyelids should be like that, straight. But here you can see, if you draw a line from medial epicanthic fold, here to here, you can see the upward slanting of the eyelids. You can see this is not straight like that, the eyelids. Eyelids are upward slanting. This is called upward slanting of the eyelid, that is the palpebral fissure, and there is epicanthic fold here. In this picture, it is not visualized, but when you practically see the patient of a Down syndrome, you can easily see the epicanthic fold. The fold of the skin is visualized here. And brush field spot, it is usually seen on the iris. It is seen by the slit lamp examination. And you can see the congenital cataract if it is present. Here, you cannot see the congenital cataract. And the low set ear, if you draw a line from the ear is low set. That is the, draw a line from medial side to lateral side, medial canthus to lateral canthus, the line will go upward here. But if it is, if the upward slanting is not there, in normal eye, if you draw from here to here, the line will intersect the ear, and one third of the ear will remain above and two third of the ear will be below the line. So here the line from the medial canthus to lateral canthus, it will go above the ear. So it is called low satire. It is another issue, but you have to tell that here is low set. You cannot see the oral cavity here, that but there is, but you can see the tongue. There is macroglossia and protruding tongue, you can see in this picture, and enamel hypoplasia, it is not visualized here. Here you can see the hand and feet, broad, short hand, clinodactyly, short and inward curving of the little finger. This finger is short and slightly curved inward. This is called clinodactyly. And you can see the single palmar crease. There are other creases, but here the crease, this crease is a single one. It is distributed from here to here, and it is a single line. This is called single palmar crease or Simeon crease. And small hands and feet. The increased gap between first and second toes and plantar crease between them. This is increased gap between first toe and the second toe. It is also called increased sandal gap. And there is a crease here. Other clinical features, low IQ ranges from 20 to 70, delayed milestone of development, mild to moderate cognitive impairment, delayed speech development, that is language is delayed, and both the short and long term memory is affected. So there is, as a whole, you can say there is mental retardation. Generalized hypotonia, the sexual development is delayed in the development of the secondary sexual characteristics. Males are infertile and females are fertile. There actually no definitive treatment is available, but you have to do the counseling regarding the nature and the future of the disease. And stimulation of the child is very important for the and it will help for the normal development of the child, not the normal development, but the stimulation will help for the development of the child. Treatment of the associated illness, if there is any, special education and occupational training is very important, and no specific treatment is available. Treatment is only supportive and as per condition of the child. Thank you all.